A horrific crash near Red Rock claims the lives of two cyclists. A tentative agreement in the Dileco Family Services strike. And the new royal heir receives a name. Good evening and thank you for being with us. A couple from the Cornwall area have been identified as the two cyclists killed in that tragic accident yesterday near the town of Red Rock.
65-year-old Robert Booth and 69-year-old Irene Booth were taking part in a cross-country tour from Vancouver before they were involved in a three-vehicle collision along Highway 1117. The pair were among 20 other cyclists in the group titled Cycle Canada on their way to the East Coast. The couple was traveling eastbound on Highway 1117 around 3 o'clock yesterday afternoon when they were struck by a pickup truck. OPP say the pickup also crossed into the oncoming lane, striking another pickup with a trailer and then a tractor-trailer unit. The two cyclists were pronounced dead at the scene. Two people in the eastbound pickup, a man and a woman from Austin, Texas, were injured and taken to hospital. The remaining group of cyclists took refuge at the Nipigon Arena before continuing on their journey this morning. But there were some who chose not to continue due to the circumstances.
Some of them, it looked like they didn't want to continue on. Some of them felt they had to get out there and do it. And I don't know if some of them were doing it just to keep the spirit of the group going. No one looked really excited about getting out there, but I think they just wanted to continue on and help them forget.
Traffic Staff Sergeant for the OPP, Ken Manti, says they are still early in their investigation, but he says accidents like this should be a reminder for safe highway traveling for both cyclists and drivers.
Cyclists should stay to the right as safely as possible so that they should be as far to the right as they can get. Drivers should obviously, when they see cyclists, should slow down, give them as much room as safely possible, and that's drivers that are oncoming and approaching them, so from both directions. If you're coming in the opposite direction, you see cyclists, you should also slow down and give them as much room as possible, especially if there's oncoming traffic.
An official with Cycle Canada says their thoughts go out to the family of the victims in the accident, and the OPP spokesperson in Nipigon says charges are pending.
After over 15 hours in negotiations yesterday, Dileco Anishinaabeg Family Services and the CEP have reached a tentative agreement. The union will be on the road tomorrow as voting on that new deal takes place across the district. Union representatives say there's nothing new offered in the agreement, but they are satisfied that their concerns have been heard. After a little over 2 weeks on the picket lines, the 350 unionized employees will start voting tomorrow, and they will continue through Monday. If the vote is favorable, the bargaining committee hopes to have it ratified by next week. Local union president Candice Lavallee says the Dileco board is looking at voting on the agreement by Friday of this week.
We believe they address the issues, and our bargaining committee is recommending that our members accept this offer. There's some really good language in there, and they'll make a very informative decision.
Lavallee expects to have a final answer later on Monday afternoon with the hopes of getting employees back on the job by August 6th.
The Treaty 3 Police Service has been given a reprieve at least for another year. The chief of the police force had previously said the service would be disbanding on August 19th due to funding issues. After an annual general meeting in Kenora yesterday, it was decided that Treaty 3 will be keeping its doors open for another year. The election of a new police board and chair has brought some positive movement. The union that represents the Treaty 3 officers says there has also been commitments made by the board to work with the union and its officers. Meanwhile, the Anishinaabe Police Service is also facing deficit problems. Acting NAPS Police Chief Bob Herman is projecting a $1.1 million shortfall next year. Herman says the province has been stepping up to cover some federal budget cuts, but it's not enough. With many of their communities being remote, their costs are significant.
Gas has gone up dramatically in the last several years. We've never received funding for that. Our operation costs of maintaining our buildings has gone up because the governments have built us new buildings, but they've never given us the money to actually run them. Our benefit costs have gone up, and that's not unique to First Nations policing. That's evident everywhere in policing.
Herman says there will be negotiations with both levels of government in Ottawa next Friday.
Number of needles handed out each year in Thunder Bay to drug users could be shocking to some. An estimated 700,000 syringes are given out annually by the District Health Unit. Now, that's an exorbitant amount, according to our mayor, who has a controversial idea for a solution. Dennis Ward has more.
Stumbling across a scene like this is not that uncommon in Thunder Bay. Coming upon needles out in the public is the number one complaint Mayor Keith Hobbs says he receives. He has some thoughts on how to reduce the needles being found, but it is controversial. Hobbs believes maybe it's time Thunder Bay looks at a safe injection site. Right now, the only one in North America is in Vancouver.
We have a huge problem, probably proportionate or worse than Vancouver per capita. If you look at those numbers and you take those to be true, maybe we need to be the second city in North America that has safe injection sites. I get swamped with phone calls about needles being disposed of and people almost stepping on needles, and police are picking them up all the time. Points are picking them up all the time, and it's a blight on our community.
63,000 needles are handed out by Superior Points each month in Thunder Bay to what's believed to be around 2,000 drug users. Rick Thompson has been working the needle exchange for 15 years and follows the debate over safe injection sites closely.
And looking at what the data tells us about how effective they are in a number of different areas, including reducing ODs, reducing the complications associated with the injection drug use, as well as providing people better access to things like detox or addiction or health facilities.
The Thunder Bay Drug Strategy Coordinator says looking into the feasibility of a safe injection site is on the radar, but not a current priority. There is government approval needed and funding, not to mention support from the public, but Thompson believes that could be achieved.
I think we could get a lot of community support if we let the people know how effective they can be, even in doing something like reducing the amount of drug litter that's in an area they've proven to be effective at.
When it comes to safety, the mayor says there are few things worse than stepping on a dirty needle, and he believes the potential of a safe injection site in Thunder Bay needs to be moved up on the drug strategy's agenda. Dennis Ward, TBT News.
The city of Thunder Bay has received its latest casino payout from the Ontario Lottery and Gaming Commission. This was the first quarterly payment under a new revenue formula announced by the province in May. But it appears any increase for the city coffers is being offset by a drop in casino users. Under the new formula, the city is now receiving a percentage of all table game revenue in addition to money from the slot machines. But OLG officials say because the table games require a lot more staff to run than the slots, the extra revenue for the city is just under $21,000. That brings the total payout for the last quarter to around $620,000. It's an 8% increase from the last quarterly payment, but compared to the same time period last year, there's actually been a slight decrease. OLG officials attribute it to a variety of possible factors, such as lower tourism numbers and lower gaming revenues.
It's Natural Resources and the Martin Falls First Nation met behind closed doors in Thunder Bay today. The topic of discussion was how to address environmental concerns with the mining giant's planned chromite mine. The federal environmental assessment process for the Cliffs Project is currently before the courts, and the chief of Martin Falls says today's meeting was about finding a framework that works for government, industry, and communities near the Ring of Fire. Chief Eli Munia says under the guidelines of the provincial and federal EA process, his community would get less than 10 minutes to present their concerns. One of the major issues surrounds chemicals that could be emitted from any mining site.
We'd like to know what chemical deposits that will come out of there. Is it going to be a danger to the river and to the air and to the animals that live there and to the hunters that use the land, etc.?
Munia says sitting down with the company can address some of the concerns nearby communities have. Cliffs Vice President Bill Boer commends Martin Falls for focusing on concerns rather than the process that's been slowing things down, like provincial negotiations.
When those issues are resolved, we'll be able to actually move forward. But when we made that announcement, we said this was more of an acknowledgement of where we are kind of stuck in the process than any decision to stop the process on our part. And I think you can tell by us being here and working hard with the community that we're doing everything we can to move forward.
Boer says he's interested in hearing the objectives of the recently appointed provincial negotiator Frank Iacobucci and Mattawa negotiator Bob Ray.
More testimony today about a leaking roof that caved in with deadly consequences at a mall in northern Ontario. The owner told an inquiry he always intended to fix it. Johanna Rouliotis reports from Elliott Lake.
The site of Elliott Lake's old shopping center is now a relic, a place that collapsed after years of water damage, killing two women.
No comments.
For a second day in a row, the mall's owner arrived to a barrage of questions about what he did or did not do to repair a roof that had been leaking for years. Bob Nazarian claims he looked and looked for a solution as soon as he bought the property in 2005.
My whole concentration was how to repair this roof so I can have dignity and have my tenants happy and bring new tenants in the mall.
But in often exasperated exchanges, the inquiry's lead lawyer challenged Nazarian on how hard he really tried.
Two leaks footwear, two leaks pet, one leak houseware.
Rhyming off leaks at the Zellers store alone, Peter Duty pointed out the town considered the damage at Zellers a fire hazard and ordered fireproofing that Nazarian never complied with.
You were ordered by the fire chief to do it, and you chose not to do it, right?
Sir.
Right?
Sir.
Isn't that right?
It was wrong.
Nazarian shot back.
Our logic was we have to fix the leak before we spray the fireproofing.
Nazarian insisted he kept trying to find a permanent fix to the leaky roof and the money to finance repairs in the range of $1 million. But when it came to details of key meetings, key memos, he was often short of answers.
I don't remember, sir. I don't recall. I don't recall this. So I don't remember, sir.
Some residents have even made T-shirts mocking everyone at the inquiry who has said as much.
There's just too many people are saying, I don't recall, because I do recall. And there's a lot of people in this community recall.
Nazarian testified he was even willing to use his own personal line of credit to get the job started and that he begged the city for a tax break to help. The mall's roof collapsed before he was able to get the money together. Johanna Rumiliotis, CBC News, Elliott Lake.
A 13-year-old boy is facing charges following a break-in at a Dawson Road lottery store. Staff discovered the break-in yesterday morning and alerted police. A quantity of cigarettes and bus passes were missing from the business. Police say the suspect was apprehended on Picton Street yesterday afternoon. He's charged with possession of stolen property and breach of probation. Police have also charged a Thunder Bay First Nations man following a drug seizure yesterday. The suspect and a female companion were observed getting off a Greyhound bus in the Current River area. When approached by officers, a brief scuffle ensued. A subsequent search turned up over 240 grams of cocaine valued at $24,000. A 31-year-old man is charged with possession for the purposes of trafficking and resisting arrest.
Traffic along Oliver Road had to be diverted today after a three-car accident brought emergency vehicles to the scene. The collision occurred shortly after noon at the intersection of Gulf Links Road and Oliver Road. Two cars and one truck were involved. The two westbound lanes were shut down as Thunder Bay police conducted their investigation. There was minor damage to two of the vehicles, and one woman was taken to the hospital with minor injuries. Police say charges are pending.
A Thunder Bay woman is hoping to bring positive change to the Chippewa Wildlife Exhibit. After recent concerns about the welfare of a moose at the park, Sarah Rizzo hopes her petition will make the idea of a wildlife rehabilitation center a reality. During a recent visit to the exhibit, Rizzo says she became concerned about the conditions, and after speaking with others, she found she wasn't alone. She started both a petition and a Facebook page to bring a voice to those concerns. She hopes to work with the city and the exhibit to implement some positive changes. Rizzo says, with the animals having lived in the park their entire lives, releasing them isn't an option. Instead, her petition calls for a shift in values towards conservation and wildlife rehabilitation.
Times are definitely changing and people are more concerned with those things now. Simply having animals on display in cages for the sake of staring at them doesn't really fly anymore. I think people want to see a purpose behind the animals being there. And I think if maybe we shifted from housing animals long term for the sake of our entertainment to housing them short term for rehabilitation purposes, it would be a better use of the funding and of the space available.
Rizzo says better maintenance, more stimulating activities for the animals, and an educational component could add to the quality of the proposed rehabilitation center. Rizzo's petition to revamp the Chippewa Wildlife Exhibit can be found on Facebook and at change.org.
A group of over 100 people from across the far north are gathering in Thunder Bay this week to discuss solutions when it comes to the region's food system challenges. The Anishinaabe Asking Nation Food Symposium has been held in our city for the past 4 years. It's a chance to discuss a sustainable, accessible, and nutritious food system for the health of First Nations people. As that population begins to grow, so do the rates of obesity and heart disease in remote communities. Today's workshops include discussions and presentations from NAN delegates.
I think that's what the whole part of these types of activities are, is to bring people together and to share and to educate each other and to learn about the issues and to solve those problems, to try and bring positive feedback in.
The NAN Food Symposium wraps up tomorrow.
Turning to weather now, Fiona, I was out in my backyard today, and 1 minute it was gorgeous sunshine out there, then just pouring down rain the next minute. That lasted for a few minutes, and then I looked out the window and sunshine again, and on it went.
Well, it's a fun time of year, I gotta say. It's a lot of variability, and that was all due to a trough of low pressure trying to move its way into the region. A little bit heavier at times, but you can see it was not a well-organized system, or at least the portion that reached us and brought some pop-up showers in the afternoon, late in the day for the most part. Despite the bit of rain, we did hit a high of 23 with the Humidex. It fell a little closer to 26, and that's with winds from the southwest at times up to 37 kilometers per hour. But for most of the day, it was actually quite light, anywhere from 10 to about 15 K. Now, at this point, we're under cloudy skies in Fort Frances. Temperatures low 20s, definitely dropping quickly as you head a little bit further north. We've got rain up towards Red Lake, more clouds in Greenstone. Sault Ste. Marie enjoying a nice bit of sunshine, just a few clouds here and there. But all in all, temperatures are definitely anywhere from 5 to 10 degrees cooler than normal for this time of year across the region. Now, tonight, we'll stay in the double digits, but low of just 12 Celsius under partly cloudy skies. There is a slight risk of more showers. As I said, it's not a well-organized system just yet, but it's working on it, and it should be much more collective by tomorrow. So get ready for some more rain in the region as the low settles closer to Thunder Bay, more into northwestern Ontario. We've got the possibility of some thunderstorms just to the south of us, so we could see one or two tomorrow. But you are definitely going to want to bring an umbrella for at least the next couple of days. Mother Nature is going to keep you on your toes. I'll have more details on how long it's going to last and what it's going to do to maybe a few of your weekend plans. It's later on in the news hour.
All right. Thanks very much, Fiona. Well, there is more royal baby news to tell you about this evening. The third in line to the throne now has a new name. In fact, it's got a few of them. We'll fill you in right after these words.
All right, Ben. Take good names.
What's in a name? Well, plenty when it comes to His Royal Highness Prince George of Cambridge. Here's Anne McMillan with the royal baby's full name announced earlier today.
Meet George Alexander Louis, each name significant. The Queen's father was King George VI. It's the most popular monarch's name in the past 300 years. Alexander is a Scottish name. William and Kate met at a university in Scotland. There were three Scottish kings named Alexander, a reminder of the monarchy's strong Scottish roots, significant at a time when Scotland faces an independence referendum next year. Louis is in memory of the Queen's beloved uncle, murdered by the Irish Republican Army. What do you think of the names?
I like them. They're good names.
George, I think, is a very good choice.
I thought of Louis, but if you had Louis as a first name, you couldn't have King Louis like Jungle Book, so...
Little Prince George spent last night here at Kensington Palace, and today he received some royal visitors. The Queen came by to meet her first great-grandson. Then, unseen by waiting journalists, Uncle Harry dropped in. Both he and his brother lived in the palace when they were young. Shortly after Harry's visit, William, Kate and George made a quick exit, heading to Bucklebury, an hour from London, to be with Kate's parents. Yesterday, when the family left hospital, William said he and Kate were just getting to know their new son. Now they're hoping for some privacy, away from all the cameras. Anne McMillan, CBC News, London.
Police have a tragic mystery on their hands in Winnipeg. Two young children are dead and their mother is missing. Cameron McIntosh has more.
Throughout this neighborhood, people say they're shocked by the deaths of a two-month-old and a two-year-old as police search for the mother of those children, 32-year-old Lisa Gibson. Now, Gibson lived in this house here behind me with her husband and the two children. She's been missing since early this morning. While the police homicide unit is currently investigating the case, right now police aren't calling her a suspect and they aren't calling this a homicide. Rather, they say they're worried about Gibson's well-being. They've been searching this neighborhood all day, including along the banks of a nearby river.
We are certainly concerned for Miss Gibson, and that is why we have taken the step of getting her picture out to the public as soon as possible. And again, I can't reiterate enough that we are asking anyone with information, if you believe you've seen Miss Gibson, to please contact us.
Now, as for what actually happened here, police are offering few details, saying only that the children were found early this morning in critical condition and taken to hospital, where they later died. Cameron McIntosh, CBC News, Winnipeg.
The country's premiers are holding 3 days of meetings in Ontario's Niagara region. Today, they held talks with Aboriginal leaders. Those leaders have been calling for a national inquiry into missing and murdered Aboriginal women. Ontario Premier Kathleen Wynne says the premiers at today's meeting support that.
The premiers at the table agreed to support the call of the NAO for a national public inquiry on this very, very important issue that really has touched every one of our jurisdictions and is extremely important to us.
The premiers of Alberta and Newfoundland and Labrador weren't at today's talks. Premier Wynne says she'll be speaking with them about whether they can support the call for an inquiry.
As mentioned, the premiers are meeting in a part of Ontario that's well known for its wines. But most Canadians can't just pick up the phone and place an order for some bottles. As Rosemary Barton explains, the provinces have the power to change that, but most of them haven't done so.
Bruce Ewart's grapes are well known in this part of Canada. He produces award-winning sparkling wine. While you can get a taste and buy a bottle if you visit his vineyard, having it delivered elsewhere in Canada is almost impossible.
Here in Nova Scotia, we've got a very unique microclimate that produces exceptional world-class sparkling wines, and the rest of Canada should have access to that.
Until last year, a federal law restricted Canadians from transporting wine between provinces for personal use. The law has been changed, but a loophole remains. Provinces must set the regulations to allow it. And for now, only British Columbia and Manitoba have opened up their borders. With some 500 wineries now in Canada, the pressure from winemakers and wine lovers is starting to build again.
We just want to be able to go to a winery, enjoy it, bring some home,
and then order some more, read a nice review on a wine, and be able to go online that night and order it and have it delivered in 3 days.
Today, premiers gathered in Ontario wine country, where BC Premier Christy Clark brought some homegrown wine for her colleagues, a not-so-subtle message to the other provinces to let the wine flow. But liquor boards across the country say they fear if people start ordering their own wine, it could mean a loss of $300 million in revenue.
Once you let the genie out of the bottle, though, you don't know. I mean, it's growing in the UK and in the US, where the tax systems aren't the same.
Winemaker Gordon Fitzpatrick says this is as much about selling tourism as it is about selling wine.
They have the experience here. They want to ship a case back home, or they want to join the wine club. I mean, what a great postcard from the Okanagan.
For now, most people who want to get the wine will still have to go to a liquor store or right to the vineyard in order to bring it home. Rosemary Barton, CBC News, Ottawa.
Some people see electric vehicles as a good way to conserve energy, but hydro officials in the country's biggest city are raising concerns. As Aaron Saltzman explains, Toronto Hydro is worried about the demands electric vehicles could put on the power system.
Melly Dreos loves his electric vehicle, perfect for his lifestyle, he says, and so convenient.
I can come in at night at home, I simply plug it in, and by the morning when I get up, it's all charged up and I'm ready to go.
With few public charging stations, most electric vehicle owners are just like Idreos. They charge their car mainly at home, and that has a cost.
Electric vehicle can be charging for up to 8 hours on your home, and that has an impact on the distribution grid.
Electric vehicles, he says, can represent 3 to 5 times the power requirement of the average inner city house, a potential issue in older neighborhoods in older cities with aging infrastructure.
We've been relying on the existing distribution transformers to feed that neighborhood, and we have what essentially introduces perhaps 2, 3, 4 times a house load right onto that street. So we have to take that into account.
There are still relatively few electric vehicles on the road, likely fewer than 1,500 in all of Ontario. But utilities don't know which homes those EVs are plugged into. So if two or more happen to be on the same outdated transformer, well, that could pose a problem. Toronto Hydro is working to modernize its power grid, a worthy investment, say electric vehicle advocates, considering the difference in greenhouse gas emissions and the savings.
It's much, much cheaper for me to drive an electric car than a gas car, and so I really think we have to think about the opportunity. And certainly there'll be issues to manage the grid, but certainly can be managed if we learn as we go.
Melly Dreos says charging his car at home adds between $8 and $13 a month to his electric bill, far less than the cost to fill up, and he never has to worry about running out of gas. Aaron Saltzman, CBC News, Toronto.
The man who leaked information about a top-secret U.S. surveillance program is still in limbo today, and the U.S. Secretary of State says he'll be disappointed if Russia doesn't keep him there. This has been Edward Snowden's view of the world since June 23rd, inside Moscow's airport, looking out. There were reports that he might be allowed to leave the international zone at the airport today. He was expecting to get documents that would allow him into Russia while his asylum request is being considered. But those documents never arrived, and Snowden is still stuck for now.
It's been a busy day for Pope Francis, who's on his first international trip since taking on the job. Early this morning, he visited one of Brazil's most holy sites, paid homage to a likeness of the Virgin Mary called the Black Virgin, who's revered by Roman Catholics there. Later, he took part in a mass at a cathedral at the site. Francis is in Brazil to take part in World Youth Day celebrations, which are expected to attract 1 million people, many of them from other countries.
An incredible video to show you now of a hot air balloon ride gone wrong. It happened yesterday east of Amsterdam. 11 people were on board, and they had some luck on their side. It happened over a lake, so it was a splashdown instead of a hard landing. And as you can see, the basket floated as the balloon dragged it onto shore. Fortunately, no one was seriously hurt. Authorities still don't know why that hot air balloon ended up in the water. Here's what happened on the markets today. In Toronto, the TSX fell 73 points to 12,672. The Dow dropped 25 points to 15,542. And the Nasdaq was relatively steady, holding at 35,79. Canadian dollar dropped about 0.3 of a cent to 96.94 cents U.S. Gold down $15 to $1,319 an ounce. Oil fell $1.84 to $105.39 a barrel. Kind of a quiet time on the local sports scene is a couple of city teams getting a bit of a break.
Yeah, the Northwoods League All-Star game last night, so last day of the All-Star break. The Border Cats will be back in action tomorrow, and also the Thunder Bay Chill. They're awaiting the conference playoffs. So those will go on the weekend, and we now know who the Chill will face in their first playoff game. The Michigan Bucks won their way into the postseason with a 4-0 victory over the Chicago Fire last night. They'll visit Chapels Park on Saturday to do battle with the Chill. Game time is 3 o'clock. What better way for the Chill to prepare for that contest than to square off against a pro team? That's what they did last night when they welcomed Minnesota United of the North American Soccer League. Mike Albanese has the highlights from yesterday's friendly.
The Thunder Bay Chill are taking on Minnesota United, a team in a higher division than them, for a friendly match before their playoffs start. For a friendly match, this didn't start off too pretty. Within the first 25 minutes, there was two takedowns that had players fuming at the refs. A few minutes later, Lucas Rodriguez of Minnesota had two chances to open the game scoring, but was just off the mark. Just before the end of the half, another close shot by Minnesota misses and more tempers start to flare. The second half started off just as hectic with more players dropping in pain, but the game soon returned to normal when Michael Reed beat the goalie to open the score 1-0 Minnesota. 10 minutes later, Travis Wall scored a rundown on Chill keeper, bringing the score up to 2-0, but they weren't done there. After a yellow card was given to a Minnesota player for a slide tackle, they returned down the field to score yet another goal, this one by Nate Polak. And finally, to cap off a not-so-perfect night for the Chill, Sean Da Silva scored a free kick, making it a 4-0 loss to put behind them before their first playoff game Saturday. Mike Albanese, TBT Sports.
The Toronto Blue Jays look to salvage the final game of their home series with the LA Dodgers. Right-hander Esmiel Rogers goes to the mound for Toronto. The Dodgers have won their last 9 road games and 22 of 27 contests overall. Last night, it was Todd Redmond making his 4th career start, 3rd this year for the Jays. He looks good early as he gets Yasiel Puig to chase a slider out of the zone, part of a 1-2-3 first. Jays open the scoring in the bottom of the 3rd, a runner aboard for Jose Reyes, who laces this 1-2 pitch from Chris Capuano off the wall in left field. Brett Laurie hustles home all the way from first base, 1-0 Blue Jays. Bottom 4, it's now tied at 2 with Mark DeRosa at the dish. And he belts one over the wall. Not even Puig can jump that high. One of 2 runs in the inning for the home side to 5. Bautista doing what he does best. He crushes his 23rd home run of the season. That's a no-doubter left. Capuano, well, he's none too happy with that turn of events. That ends his night as the Blue Jays extend their lead to 5-2. Jays now up 5-3 in the 6th. Reyes, known more for his speed than his power, has himself a nice little 2-run shot. Number 5 on the year for Reyes. Toronto comfortably in front, 8-3. But back come the Dodgers in the 7th. After Jays reliever Brett Cecil walked in a run, Dustin McGowan in to replace him, and McGowan gives up a single to Ellis. 2 runs come across, and just like that, we have got ourselves a ball game. It is now 8-6. Next inning, Darren Oliver in the game for the Jays, in some trouble facing Adrian Gonzalez with 2 on and nobody out. And Gonzalez takes Oliver for a ride. LA takes its first lead of the ball game. 2 batters later, Andre Ethier, why not? The Blue Jays somehow managed to snatch defeat from the jaws of victory, giving up 4 runs in the 8th. The Dodgers take this game 10-9. They've now won 5 in a row, while the Jays' losing streak is stretched to 6 games and counting. Zach Theak was the lone Thunder Bay Border Cat invited to participate in yesterday's Northwoods League All-Star Game. The 19-year-old relief pitcher did his job. He pitched 1 inning, allowing a hit while walking another and striking out 1 batter. He's the pitcher of record, earning the victory. Rochester's Carter Burgess was named the game's MVP. He went 2-for-5 at the plate with an RBI and 2 runs scored. St. Cloud's Adam Martin won the home run derby with 25 total homers. 12 of those came in the final round to beat Trip Martin of the Green Bay Bullfrogs. In Little League action, the Port Arthur Nationals junior team is on the field right now in Ottawa taking on the East Nepean Eagles. The Nats won yesterday's game against Kempville 3-0. Fort William, meanwhile, has been eliminated from contention in the major tournament in Castleman, Ontario, this after falling 9-2 to Timmins. Well, Patrick Sharp says it's an honor to be among the 47 players invited to Canada's Olympic orientation camp. Sharp is one of 25 forwards vying for a spot on Team Canada to defend Olympic gold in Sochi, Russia. The team is expected to be comprised of 14 forwards, 8 defensemen, and 3 goalies. So Sharp knows the competition will be fierce.
Up and down the lineup of guys that are invited to it. We're just some very lucky players. So feels good. I'm excited about that. It's definitely a personal goal of mine to make the team, and that's the first step. There's a lot of hockey to be played, and I don't think you can go wrong with taking any of those players on the roster. So I know it's going to be a tough team, a tough lineup to make, but we'll see what happens.
The 2-time Stanley Cup champion is one of 4 Thunder Bay players, alongside Eric Mark and Jordan Staal, to be invited to the camp. Northwestern Ontario natives Duncan Keith and Mike Richards are also on the list.
It says a lot about the support and the hockey system we have in Northwestern Ontario. It's a great place for me to grow up and play the game. The competition was strong, and I couldn't be more proud to be from that area.
As for his day with the Stanley Cup, Sharp is promising he'll hold another public event in Thunder Bay like the one he staged in 2010. The 31-year-old says it's still up in the air how his public day with the Cup will unfold. He's leaving the details in the hands of his parents. Well, Robert Bortuzzo and the Pittsburgh Penguins have avoided salary arbitration. The Thunder Bay defenseman and the club agreed today on a 2-year, $1.2 million contract. The Pens and Bortuzzo had been scheduled for an arbitration hearing next Thursday. The 24-year-old former Fort William North Star had 2 goals and 2 assists in 15 games for Pittsburgh last season. He also appeared in 31 games for the club's AHL affiliate, where he had 1 goal and 3 assists. Bortuzzo was a restricted free agent. Well, it didn't take Brandon Isaac long to find a new home. The veteran linebacker signed with the Hamilton Tiger Cats a day after being released by the Argos. Hamilton added Isaac to its roster after letting go of veteran linebacker Markeith Knowlton. The Canadian Open swings into action tomorrow. It's been a good long while since a homegrown golfer has won the tournament. Here's a look at this year's Canadian contingent and what the chances are of a Canuck win on home soil.
It's been a generation of devastation for homegrown golfers at the Canadian Open. Not since Pat Fletcher's win in 1954 has a Canuck captured the national title.
I mean, it's hard to win, but it would definitely be nice to see, if it's not myself, any of the Canadians, at least in the hunt to, you know, just kind of make it a little more thrilling for the fans.
This year, Graham Dillette may be Canada's best chance. The Weyburn, Saskatchewan product grew up on a prairie golf course, giving up his dreams of the NHL and turning to the links of golf.
My dad and my mom, you know, kind of taught me the game. We didn't have a head professional or anything until I was, you know, mid-teens. So everything that I kind of learned was just, you know, self-taught and, you know, watching guys.
But Dillette isn't the only golfer from the Great White North.
Because that shot by Hearn might be good enough.
David Hearn's career is rocketing up at the right time.
You know, I feel like I've been playing great golf this season, and I played some nice golf last season as well, so I'm just continuing to build and get better, and, you know, it's just going to give me more confidence going forward.
Ironically, Dillette and Hearn will be paired together for the first 2 rounds.
I think it's going to be a lot of fun. I mean, we're obviously going to have some good crowds, and hopefully we can feed off each other, and, you know, it's one of those groups where you can legitimately cheer for the other guy that you're playing with.
Along with Dillette and Hearn, there are 19 Canadians in the field this week looking to end that 59-year drought since Pat Fletcher won it in Vancouver. But it's going to be no easy task, that is for sure. 9 of the top 30 players in the FedEx Cup standings come into Glen Abbey this week looking to capture a Canadian Open. Reporting from Glen Abbey and the 2013 Canadian Open, Derek Myers, Global Sports.
They've got the hopes of a nation on their shoulders. No pressure.
And the way we see it on the PGA Tour this year, anything is possible.
It
from week
really
to
is.
Week, things shift greatly. Yeah. So keep your fingers crossed.
Yes.
All right. Thanks very much, Ryan.
All right. Well, for Corey Monteith fans, they can see the actor's final and best scenes from Glee now that the show has returned to our lineup starting tonight with more. Here's your complete lineup on Teletalk.
Tonight on Global Thunder Bay, we've got a whole lot of bad behavior. Starting at 8 on Big Brother, egos, attitudes, and racism continues to wreak havoc in the house. Then at 9 on Glee, new directions take on the Warblers as the club celebrate the music of Michael Jackson. And at 10 on Camp, Mac and her crew prepare for the annual mixer with Camp Ridgefield. Over on CKPR Thunder Bay, it's a night of major deals and family squabbles. First at 8 p.m., a helmet innovation makes an impact on the investors on Dragon's Den. And at 9 on Republic of Doyle, Jake battles the clock as he searches for a kidnapped girl. Teletalk is brought to you by Points, the traffic ticket specialists.
Well, here in Thunder Bay, we're seeing a few degrees cooler than what is seasonal for this time of the year. And Fiona, much of the country is seeing a little bit of a cool down.
Yeah, and probably appreciated because it has been pretty hot, pretty muggy in a lot of parts of the country. Thunder Bay, a cool down actually came to about 23 Celsius with the Humidex 26, and that is a far cry from where we were at, say, a week ago. So, you know, a little bit of a break from the heat, not necessarily a bad thing. If we take a look what's going on out west, though, despite some slightly cooler temperatures in some areas, lots of sunshine happening. Prince George right now is 27, probably one of the hotter locations in the country at this hour. But severe thunderstorm warning is in the west, in southern southwestern Alberta, and that extends all the way to Calgary, despite the fact they've got some sunshine. They're in for some rain and some light shows tonight. A thunderstorm watch is in effect for southwestern Saskatchewan. Regina at this hour, currently 23, and partly cloudy skies. They too are preparing for the rain to come in. And Winnipeg at this hour, 21. Cloudy skies. They have had some periods of rain, but with the Humidex earlier today, and actually even right now, it feels closer to 28, so a little bit on the muggy side for southern Manitoba. Now, a cool day in Toronto and all the way up into Ottawa. In fact, 21 seems to be the high so far for Toronto right now. Both cities are expecting to see a little bit of a warm-up by Friday, but as far as cool temperatures, they've got nothing on Quebec City, where temperatures have actually been dropping for the last 24 hours straight. Now heading into the Maritimes, Fredericton, cloudy, rainy, and thunder showers in the region. They're currently at 21 Celsius. Charlottetown at 24 is preparing for rain tonight. Halifax saying goodbye to sunshine as well. They're currently at 21. They're expecting to need umbrellas probably until, ironically, Sunday. And then as you head into St. John's, they're currently at 21 under cloudy skies, but the Humidex actually hit 35 this afternoon in St. John's, so a very hot day. Now, if we take a look at what's causing all of this gray skies and precipitation, at least in northwestern Ontario, this warm front kind of rotating around, and the low is going to be developing as it moves into the region a little bit more fully tomorrow. This is where we get a little bit more depth and a little bit more organization to the system, and it's also collecting some moisture off the Great Lakes. So what it's going to do is it's going to bring more rain tomorrow, possibly a thunderstorm at some point. And as we head into Friday, it's going to move out, most of the rain hitting southern Ontario, but it's still a possibility of some precipitation here and there on Friday afternoon as well. Temperature-wise, we're in a seasonal, if slightly below seasonal range, low 20s, fairly consistent across the region tonight in the low double digits, but then tomorrow you'll notice there's pockets of cooler air and it develops into Friday and yes, Saturday. In fact, Saturday is going to be quite a cool day. I'll show you that in just a moment. Across the region tonight, thunderstorms possible for Fort Frances all the way up into Red Lake where they're looking at showers. And the rain seems to be felt pretty much everywhere except for Sault Ste. Marie, not quite hitting it yet. That could change tomorrow, though. A lot of instability as that low moves in, and temperatures definitely on the cool side, high teens where we should usually be seeing mid-20s. Now at this hour, we're at 21 under partly cloudy skies, a low of 12 tonight, slight risk of showers over the next few hours. And tomorrow, as you can see, temperatures not where we'd like to see them, a high of 18 and a possibility of passing showers by about midday. Temperatures drop to 17, and then on Saturday, no, that's not an error, 13 with periods of rain. The good news is they warm up and the sun comes back out just in time for Sunday and Monday with temperatures of 20 and 23. So keep the umbrellas handy. You're going to need them for the next 48, possibly 72 hours.
All right. Thanks very much, Fiona. Well, for many of us, there is nothing better than that first cup of coffee in the morning. It's made even better still, though, when it's free. And that's exactly what happened for hundreds of people in Edmonton recently. We'll have that story for you right after these words. Many of us start off our day with a cup of coffee, so here's a story that may help to perk up your day. A mystery man walked into a Tim Hortons in downtown Edmonton recently and plopped down nearly $900, all to buy a total group of strangers a cup of coffee.
Someone coming, and then he said, oh, I want to buy 500 coffees. And I was like, why? And he was like, no reason.
No, that's free.
Now, the final receipt came out to exactly $895.28, very little tip. Any customer was able to order any size until the credit ran out, and the mystery donor, well, he remains a mystery.
Very
no,
kind.
No tip.
Bit of a high
talk about a cheapskate.
We're going to recap our top story now. Well, a three-vehicle collision along Highway 1117 yesterday has claimed the life of two cyclists from the Cornwall area. 65-year-old and 69-year-old Irene Booth and Robert Booth passed away when a truck hit them near Red Rock. That's all the time we have for you this evening. Thank you so much for joining us. We'll see you again next time.